This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Presidential election results map. Red denotes states won by Harrison, Reid. Blue denotes those won by Cleveland, Stevenson. Light green denotes those won by Weaver. Field numbers indicate the number of electoral votes allotted to each state president before election. Benjamin Harrison, Republican, elected president. Grover Cleveland, Democratic. The United States presidential election of 1892 was the 27th quadrennial presidential election, held on Tuesday, November 8, 1892. It witnessed a rematch of the closely contested presidential election in 1888. Former Democratic President Grover Cleveland and incumbent Republican President Benjamin Harrison both ran for election to a second term in 1888. Cleveland won the popular vote over Harrison, but lost in the Electoral College in a rematch. Cleveland won both the popular and electoral vote, thus becoming the first and to date only person in American history to be elected to a second, non-consecutive presidential term, and is also the only person to win a rematch against an incumbent president. The new Populist Party, formed by groups from the Grange, the Farmers' Alliances, and the Knights of Labor, also fielded a ticket. They polled best in the West, winning in five states and taking a total of 22 electoral votes. The campaign centered mainly on economic issues, especially the concept of a sound currency. Cleveland was a proponent of the gold standard, while the Republicans and Populists both supported bimetallism. Cleveland also ran on a platform of lowering tariffs. The Republicans were strongly protectionist and opposed the Republicans' 1890 voting rights proposal. As of 1892, Cleveland was one of only two people, the other being Andrew Jackson, to win the popular vote in three U.S. presidential elections in the 20th century. Franklin Delano Roosevelt eventually exceeded this distinction by winning the popular vote in four consecutive elections. As of 1944, Cleveland also became the first Democrat to be nominated by his party three times, a distinction matched later only by William Jennings Bryan and exceeded by Roosevelt. Contents: 1. Nominations. 11. Republican Party nomination. 12. Democratic Party nomination. 13. People's Party nomination. 131 candidates gallery. 14. Prohibition Party nomination. 141 candidates gallery. 15. Socialist Labor Party nomination. 2. General election. 21. Campaign. 22. Results. 23. Geography of results. 231 cartographic gallery. 24. Results by state. 25. Close states. 3. See also. 4. References. 5. Bibliography. 6. External links. Nominations. Republican Party nomination. Main article. 1892 Republican National Convention. Harrison, Reid campaign poster. Benjamin Harrison's administration was widely viewed as unsuccessful, and as a result, Thomas C. Platt, a political boss in New York, and other disaffected party leaders mounted a Dump Harrison movement coalescing around veteran candidate James G. Blaine from Maine, a favorite of Republican Party regulars. Blaine had been the Republican nominee in 1884 when he was beaten by Democrat Grover Cleveland privately. Harrison did not want to be re-nominated for the presidency, but he remained opposed to the nomination going to Blaine, who he was convinced intended to run, and thought himself the only candidate capable of preventing such an occurrence. Blaine, however, did not want another fight for the nomination and a rematch against Cleveland at the general election. His health had begun to fail, and three of his children had recently died, Walker and Alice in 1890, and Emmons in 1892. Blaine refused to run actively, but the cryptic nature of his responses to a draft effort fueled speculation that he was not averse to such a movement for his part. Benjamin Harrison curtly demanded that he either renounce his supporters or resign his position as Secretary of State, with Blaine choosing the latter a scant 3 days before the National Convention. A boom began to build around the draft Blaine effort, with supporters hoping to cause a break towards their candidate Senator John Sherman from Ohio, who had been the leading candidate for the nomination at the 1888 Republican Convention. Before Harrison actually won it, was also brought up again as a possible challenger like Blaine. However, he was averse to another bitter battle for the nomination and, like the rebels down south, want to be let alone. This inevitably turned attention to Ohio's Governor William McKinley, who was indecisive as to his intentions. In spite his ill feelings toward Harrison and popularity among the Republican base, he was not averse to receiving the nomination, but did not expect to win it either. However, should Blaine and Harrison fail to attain the nomination after a number of ballots, he felt he could be brought forth as a Harmony candidate despite the urging of Republican powerbroker Mark Hanna. McKinley would not openly put himself out as a potential candidate, afraid of offending Harrison Stevenson and Blaine's supporters, while also feeling that the coming elections would not favor the Republicans in any case. The president's forces had the nomination locked up by the time delegates met in Minneapolis, Minnesota. On June 7-10, 1892, Richard Thomas from Indiana delivered Harrison's nominating speech. Harrison was nominated on the first ballot with 53,517 votes to 18,283 for Blaine, 182 for McKinley, and the rest scattered. McKinley protested when the Ohio delegation threw its entire vote in his name, despite not being formally nominated, but Joseph Foraker, who headed the delegation, managed to silence him on a point of order with the ballots counted. Many observers were surprised at the strength of the McKinley vote, which nearly overtook Blaine Whitelaw Reid from New York, editor of the New York Tribune and recent United States ambassador to France, was nominated for vice president. The incumbent vice president, Levi Morton, was supported by many at the convention, including Reid himself, but he did not wish to serve another term. Harrison also did not want to have Morton on the ticket. Democratic Party nomination main articles, Grover Cleveland presidential campaign, 1892 and 1892 Democratic National Convention. Cleveland, Stevenson campaign poster. By the beginning of 1892, many Americans were ready to return to Cleveland's political policies. Although he was the clear frontrunner for the Democratic presidential nomination, he was far from the universal choice of the party's supporters. Many, such as the journalists Henry Watterson and Charles Dana, thought that if he were to attain the nomination, their party would lose in November, but there were few capable of challenging him effectively. Though he had remained relatively quiet on the issue of silver versus gold, often deferring to bimetallism, Senate Democrats in January 1891 voted for free coinage of silver. Furious, he sent a letter to Ellery Anderson, who headed the New York Reform Club, to condemn the party's apparent drift towards inflation and agrarian control, the dangerous and reckless experiment of free, unlimited coinage of silver at our mints. Advisors warned that such statements might alienate potential supporters in the South and West and risk his chances for the nomination, but Cleveland felt that being right on the issue was more important than the nomination. After making his position clear, Cleveland worked to focus his campaign on tariff reform, hoping that the silver issue would dissipate. A challenger emerged in the form of David Hill, former governor of an incumbent senator from New York in favor of bimetallism and tariff reform. Hill hoped to make inroads with Cleveland's supporters while appealing to those in the South and Midwest that were not keen on nominating Cleveland for a third consecutive time. Hill had begun to run for the position of president unofficially as early as 1890, and he even offered former Postmaster General Donald Dickinson his support for the vice presidential nomination. He was not able to escape his past association with Tammany Hall, however, which he supported along machine politics, and the lack of confidence in his ability to defeat Cleveland for the nomination kept Hill from attaining the support he needed. By the time of the convention, Cleveland could count on the support of majority of the state Democratic parties, though his native New York remained pledged to Senator Hill in a narrow first ballot victory. Cleveland received 61,733 votes, barely 10 more than needed, to 114 for Senator Hill from New York, 103 for Governor Horace Boies of Iowa, a Populist and former Republican, and the rest scattered. Although the Cleveland forces preferred Isaac P. Gray from Indiana for vice president, Cleveland directed his own support to the convention favorite, Adlai E. Stevenson from Illinois, as a supporter of using paper greenbacks and free silver to inflate the currency and alleviate economic distress in rural districts. Stevenson balanced the ticket headed by Cleveland, who supported hard money and the gold standard at the same time. It was hoped that his nomination would represent a promise not to ignore regulations, and so potentially get Hill and Tammany Hall to support the Democratic ticket to their fullest in the coming election. People's Party nomination populist candidates, James B. Weaver, former U.S. Representative from Iowa. James H. Kyle, U.S. Senator from South Dakota. Leonidas L. Polk, former Representative from North Carolina. Walter Q. Gresham, appellate judge from Indiana. Candidates gallery. James B. Weaver from Iowa. Senator James H. Kyle from South Dakota. Leonidas L. Polk from North Carolina died June 11, 1892. Appellate Judge Walter Q. Gresham from Indiana declined to be nominated. Weaver, field campaign poster. In 1891, the American Farmers Alliances met with delegates from labor and reform groups in Cincinnati, Ohio, to discuss the formation of a new political party. They formed the People's Party, commonly known as the Populists. A year later in St. Louis, Missouri, Leonidas L. Polk was the initial frontrunner campaigner for the presidential nomination, he had been instrumental in the party's formation and held great appeal with its agrarian base, but he unexpectedly died while in Washington, D.C. On June 11, another candidate mentioned frequently for the nomination was Walter Q. Gresham, an appellate judge who had made a number of rulings against the railroads that made him a favorite of some farmer and labor groups, and it was felt that his rather dignified image would make the populists appear as more than a minor contender. Both Democrats and Republicans feared his nomination for this reason, and while Gresham toyed with the idea, he ultimately was not ready to make a complete break with the two parties, declining petitions for his nomination right up to and during the populist convention. Later he would endorse Grover Cleveland for the presidency at the first populist national convention in Omaha, Nebraska, in July 1892. James B. Weaver from Iowa was nominated for president on the first ballot, now lacking any serious opposition, while his nomination brought with him significant campaigning experience from over several decades. He also had a longer tract of history for which Republicans and Democrats could criticize him, and he also alienated many potential supporters in the South. Having participated in Sherman's march to the sea, James G. Field from Virginia was nominated for vice president to try and rectify this problem while also attaining the regional balance often seen in Republican and Democratic tickets: presidential ballot, vice presidential ballot, ballot first. James B. Weaver 995, James G. Field 733, James H. Kyle 265, Ben Stockton, Terrell 554, Seymour F. Norton 1 Man Page 1 Others 1 Source, U.S. President, P. Convention Our Campaigns September 7, 2009 Source, U.S. Vice President, P. Convention Our Campaigns September 7, 2009 The Populist Platform called for nationalization of the telegraph, telephone, and railroads, free coinage of silver, a graduated income tax, and creation of postal savings banks. Prohibition Party Nomination Main Article, 1892 Prohibition National Convention Prohibition Candidates, John Bidwell, former U.S. Representative from California Gideon T. Stewart, Prohibition Party Chairman from Ohio William Jennings Demarest, Magazine Publisher from New York Candidates Gallery John Bidwell from California Prohibition Party Chairman Gideon T. Stewart from Ohio Magazine Publisher William J. Demarest from New York National Prohibition Convention, Cincinnati, Ohio, 1892 The 6th Prohibition Party National Convention assembled in Music Hall in Cincinnati, Ohio. There were 972 delegates present from all states except Louisiana and South Carolina. Two major stories about the convention loomed before it assembled in the first place. Some members of the National Committee sought to merge the Prohibition and Populist parties while there appeared a likelihood that the merger would materialize. It was clear that it was not going to happen by the time that the convention convened. Secondly, the Southern states sent a number of black delegates. Cincinnati hotels refused to serve meals to blacks and whites at the same time, and several hotels refused service to the black delegates altogether. The convention nominated John Bidwell from California for president on the first ballot prior to the convention. The race was thought to be close between Bidwell and William Jennings Demarest, but the New York delegation became irritated with Demarest and voted for Bidwell 73-7. James B. Cranfill from Texas was nominated for vice president on the first ballot with 417 votes to 351 for Joshua Levering from Maryland and 45 for others. Presidential ballot, ballot first, John Bidwell 590, Gideon T. Stewart 179. William Jennings Demarest 139 H. Clay Bascom 3 Source, U.S. President, P. Convention Our Campaigns May 9, 2010 Socialist Labor Party Nomination The first Socialist Labor Party National Convention assembled in New York City and, despite running on a platform that called for the abolition of the positions of President and Vice President, decided to nominate candidates for those positions, Simon Wing from Massachusetts for President and Charles Matchett from New York for Vice President. They were on the ballot in five states: Connecticut, Massachusetts, New Jersey, New York, and Pennsylvania. General Election Campaign Main Article, Grover Cleveland Presidential Campaign, 1892 Cleveland, Stevenson Poster. The tariff issue dominated this rather lackluster campaign. Harrison defended the protectionist McKinley tariff passed during his term for his part, Cleveland assured voters that he opposed absolute free trade and would continue his campaign for a reduction in the tariff. Cleveland also denounced the Lodge Bill, a voting rights bill that sought to protect the rights of African American voters in the South. William McKinley campaigned extensively for Harrison, setting the stage for his own run 4 years later. The campaign took a somber turn when, in October, First Lady Caroline Harrison died despite the ill health that had plagued Mrs. Harrison since her youth and had worsened in the last decade. She often accompanied Mr. Harrison on official travels. On one such trip, to California in the spring of 1891, she caught a cold. It quickly deepened into her chest, and she was eventually diagnosed with tuberculosis. A summer in the Adirondack Mountains failed to restore her to health and invalid the last 6 months of her life. She died in the White House on October 25, 1892, just 2 weeks before the national election. As a result, all of the candidates ceased campaigning. Results by county explicitly indicating the percentage for the winning candidate. Shades of blue are for Cleveland Democratic, shades of red are for Harrison Republican, and shades of green are for Weaver Populist. The margin in the popular vote for Cleveland was 400,000, the largest since Grant's re-election in 1872. The Democrats won the presidency and both houses of Congress for the first time since 1856. President Harrison's re-election bid was a decisive loss in both the popular and electoral count, unlike President Cleveland's re-election bid 4 years earlier, in which he won the popular vote, but lost the electoral vote. Cleveland was the third of only five presidents to win re-election with a smaller percentage of the popular vote than in previous elections, although in the two prior such incidents, James Madison in 1812 and Andrew Jackson in 1832, not all states held popular elections. Ironically, Cleveland saw his popular support decrease not only from his electoral win in 1884, but also from his electoral loss in 1888. A similar vote decrease would happen again for Franklin D. Roosevelt in 1940 and 1944 and Barack Obama in 2012 at the county level. The Democratic candidate fared much better than the Republican candidate. The Republicans' vote was not nearly as widespread as the Democrats in 1892. It was still a sectionally based party, mainly situated in the East, Midwest, and West, and was barely visible south of the Mason-Dixon line. In only a few counties in the South was the party holding on. In East Tennessee and Tidewater, Virginia, the vote at the county level showed some strength, but it barely existed in Alabama, Mississippi, and Texas. In a continuation of its collapse there during the 1890 congressional elections, the Republican Party even struggled in its Midwestern strongholds, where general electoral troubles from economic woes were acutely exacerbated by the promotion of temperance laws. And in Wisconsin and Illinois, the aggressive support of state politicians for English-only compulsory education laws. Such policies, which particularly in the case of the latter were associated with an upwelling of nativist and anti-Catholic attitudes amongst their supporters, resulted in the defection of large sections of immigrant communities, especially Germans, to the Democratic Party. Cleveland carried Wisconsin and Illinois with their 36 combined electoral votes, a Democratic victory not seen in those states since 1852 and 1856, respectively, and which would not be repeated until Woodrow Wilson's election in 1912. While not as dramatic a loss as in 1890, it would take until the next election cycle for more moderate Republican leaders to pick up the pieces left by the reformist crusaders and bring alienated immigrants back to the fold of the 2,683 counties making returns. Cleveland won in 1,389, 5,177%, Harrison carried 1,017, 3,791%, while Weaver placed first in 276, 1,029%. One county 0.04% split evenly between Cleveland and Harrison. Populist James B. Weaver, calling for free coinage of silver and an inflationary monetary policy, received such strong support in the West that he became the only third-party nominee between 1860 and 1912 to carry a single state. The Democratic Party did not have a presidential ticket on the ballot in the states of Colorado, Idaho, Kansas, North Dakota, or Wyoming, and Weaver won the first four of these states. Weaver also performed well in the South as he won counties in Alabama, Georgia, Mississippi, North Carolina, and Texas. Populists did best in Alabama, where electoral chicanery probably carried the day for the Democrats. The prohibition ticket received 270,879, or 22% nationwide. It was the largest total vote and highest percentage of the vote received by any Prohibition Party national ticket. Wyoming, having attained statehood 2 years earlier, became the first state to allow women to to vote in a presidential election since 1804. Women in New Jersey had the right to vote under the state's original constitution, but this right was rescinded in 1807. Wyoming was also one of six states, along with North Dakota, South Dakota, Montana, Washington, and Idaho, participating in their first presidential election. Other than the first election, the most in American history, electors from the state of Michigan were selected using the congressional district method. The winner in each congressional district wins one electoral vote. The winner of the state wins two electoral votes. This resulted in a split between the Republican and Democratic electors, 9 for Harrison and 5 for Cleveland in Oregon. The direct election of presidential electors, combined with the fact that one Weaver elector was endorsed by the Democratic Party and elected as a fusionist, resulted in a split between the Republican and Populist electors, 3 for Harrison and 1 for Weaver in California. The direct election of presidential electors, combined with the close race, resulted in a split between the Republican and Democratic electors, 8 for Cleveland and 1 for Harrison in Ohio. The direct election of presidential electors, combined with the close race, resulted in a split between the Republican and Democratic of electors, 22 for Harrison and 1 for Cleveland in North Dakota. Two electors from the Democratic Populist Fusion ticket won and one Republican elector won. This created a split delegation of electors, one for Weaver, one for Harrison, and one for Cleveland. This was the first occasion in which incumbent presidents were defeated in two consecutive elections. This would not happen again until 1980. Presidential candidate party home state popular vote electoral vote. Running mate count PCT vice presidential candidate home state elect vote Grover Cleveland Democratic New York 5,553,898 4,602% 277 Adlai E. Stevenson Illinois 277 Benjamin Harrison incumbent Republican Indiana 5,190,819 4,301% 145 Whitelaw Reid New York 145 James B. Weaver Populist Iowa 1,026,595 851% 22 James G. Field, Virginia 22 John Bidwell Prohibition California 270,879 224% 0 James Cranfield Texas 0 Simon Wing Socialist Labor Massachusetts 21,173 018% 0 Charles Matchett New York 0 Other 4,673 004% Other, total 12,068,037 100% 444,444 needed to win 223,223 Source popular vote, Lape, David 1892 Presidential election results Dave Lape's Atlas of U.S. Presidential Elections retrieved July 27, 2005. 4,602% Harrison. Results by state source, data from Walter Dean Burnham, Presidential Ballots, 1836-1892 Johns Hopkins University Press, 1955 pp 247-57 States won by Cleveland, Stevenson States won by Harrison, Reed States won by Weaver, Field Grover Cleveland Democratic Benjamin Harrison Republican James Weaver Populist John Bidwell Prohibition Simon Wing Socialist Labor Margin State Total. State Electoral Votes Hash. Votes hash. 240,010 53,151 2,286 232,543 Al Arkansas 887,834 5,938 47,072 3,178 11,831 799-113-008 40,762 2,752 148,117 R. California 9 118,174 4,383 8 118,027 4,378 125,311 939 8,096 300 147,005 269,609 CA Colorado 438,620 4,113 53,584 5,707 41,687 180-14,964-1,594 93,891 CO Connecticut 682,395 5006 677,032 4680-809-049 4026 245-333 020 5363 326 164,595 CT Delaware 3 18,581 4,993 18,077 4,855 564,151 504,135 37,235 De Florida 4 30,153 8,501 4 4,843 1365 475,134 25,310 7,135 35,471 FL Georgia 13 129,446 5,801 13 48,408 2,170 41,939 1880 988,044 81,038 3,632 223,126 Ga Idaho 3 8,599 4,431 10,525 421 3 288 148 -1,921 -990 19,407 ID Illinois 24 426,281 4,879 24 399,288 4,570 22,207 254 25,871 296 26,993 309